The first one I want to talk about is taking sales deposits. Now, this year's CPD, we're talking about the rules of conduct, the 19, Schedule 1, the 19 rules of conduct. In Schedule 2, there's the specific rules of conduct for sales, the specific rules of conduct for property management. Then it comes into, there are more specific rules of conduct for strata. Every agency type, so every category of license, has the main 19 rules of conduct plus more for your specific license category. So guys, you actually have to make sure that you're adhering to those, because there are penalties for breaching any of those rules of conduct. Now, I heard a story this week, and it was from an agent wanting some advice around what to do with a deposit that she had taken. Now, this deposit she'd taken was from a prospective purchaser of property. Obviously, it was a 10% deposit, and we're talking a lot of money here. So we're talking in the hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars. Now, she had been dealing with a purchaser of a property, and that purchaser had a very, very long settlement on the property that they had purchased. She was not the sales agent on that property. So she was talking to the purchaser, and the purchaser said, hey, I've got another, 5 month extension on my settlement on this. So, like, as I said, really long settlement period. I'm going to have difficulty in actually meeting that settlement in terms of getting the finance for that. Can you perhaps find another purchaser for it? Now, the deal that first purchaser wanted was to actually on-sell it at a higher price, keep the difference, and then the vendor wouldn't know that there was any change in the contract. Yet not possible. Clearly, because the vendor has to sign the final contract for sale, and make sure that it will transfer of title will occur. So now the agent had taken a deposit from the second purchaser on a possible sale from the first purchaser, who actually had no interest in the land at this stage, because the only way they'd paid a 10% deposit in the form of a bank guarantee. So all really, really convoluted, really, really confusing to get heads around in the first place. But one, she had no authority to be actually selling the property. She'd never spoken to the vendor, didn't know the vendor, had no agency agreement with the vendor. They had no authority to be taking money and putting it into her trust account. Yes, she put it into her trust account. But this is really, amazing bits and pieces. And I spoke to a few different people about it today. And it seems that, a number of agents are being asked to do this for people who are unable to settle on a property for which they have purchased. And it's not, some are secondhand properties, some are off the plan property. So there was no great detail about there was one more than the other, or this is only happening in off the plan sales. It's not, it's happening in secondhand sales as well. So it really is something you need to be very, very careful about, not to get in the middle of as an agent. I know it's a tough market, and I know, a sale's a sale, and you want to make some commission and run your business, but you also have to have authority from the vendor to be able to talk to purchasers about the property, have a contract for the property, and actually offer it to market. So otherwise you can't be taking deposits on something on behalf of somebody else who actually has no interest in the land and cannot sell the property. So quite a convoluted story there, but just remembering about all of the rules of conduct in terms of your fiduciary duty, acting fairly and honestly and in a professional way, acting in the best interest of the client. All of these rules of conduct that are there to protect the consumer and to make sure that you are compliant with those, this was actually not happening. So whilst this particular agent was trying to do the right thing and get a sale across the line, it wasn't actually in the best interest of the vendor of the property, who was actually, the person who had the authority to be able to give that to the agent. So yeah, all around the world there in terms of the actual scenario. But you've got to make sure that you as an agent are adhering to each of the rules of conduct, that you are adhering to, remember, the supervision guidelines. Section 32 of the Act is saying that every agent must comply with the supervision guidelines. The first two of those requirements, there are six requirements under the supervision guidelines, and I know I've talked about them many, many times before, even on Facebook Live, in our newsletters, and certainly talking about it all the time in training, is those six requirements. The first two are about trust money, in terms of making sure that you have processes and checklists about the authorities and the way you are taking trust money, accounting for trust money, and accounting to your clients for that. So there's your fiduciary duty on that, and also there's the supervision guidelines that you need to adhere to. So just please be careful when you're taking sales deposits that you can.